sucks.
Good morning. I would like to call the Conference Committee for Education, Finance, and Policy together. I hope everybody had a wonderful weekend. We are going to get started here with member introductions, but a few housekeeping things first. And that is, just wanted to point out our two committee administrators who will be the point person. We have Polly Sukvenik for the House and Dana Elling for the Senate. And then our nonpartisan staff will be kind of introducing themselves as they do the walkthroughs. With that, too, as a reminder, we will not be taking any testimony in conference committee per usual. Kind of that's been historic, but we do accept letters to the committees if you just want to send them to Ms. Venick or Ms. Elling. So with that, I think I would love to have at least our conferees introduce themselves, starting with Chair Kunesh.
Good morning, everyone. This is exciting. And members from the Senate, just so you know, these mics are on unless you push mute. So it's always best to push this away if you're speaking to anyone. Otherwise, the mics are hot. And I'm Senator Kunesh and happy to be back in the House.
And we'll just go right down the row if Senator Studinski or Chair Studinski wants to go next.
Hi, everybody. Steve Swadzinski, chair of the policy committee. This is it's pretty cool to be here in the House and out of the Senate for a while. So anyways, thanks for being here today, everybody.
Hi, I'm Heather Gustafson. I represent the White Bear Lake area, Lino Lakes area. And it is good to be here. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Zach Duckworth, Senate District 57, which is Lakeville, Elko New Market, Credit River, and Eureka Township. Thanks.
Thank you. And then I'll go next to me to Chair Pryor.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Representative Lori Pryor. I'm the chair of the House Policy Committee. Great to be here. I represent House District 49A.
Good morning. I'm Representative Mary Frances Clardy. I represent 53A, and I'm vice chair of Ed Finance.
Good morning. I'm Josiah Hill. I represent District 33B, which is along the St. Croix River over in the East Metro.
And good morning, Representative Ron Crescia. I represent the Morrison County, Crow Wing, Kennebec, Mille Lacs now counties.
Thank you. And members, I am Representative Cheryl Joachim, Chair of the Education Finance Committee, and I represent Hopkins, St. Louis Park, and Edina. So with that, I think we'll roll right into having Commissioner Jett come up and join us and give some opening comments. Commissioner Jett, go ahead and state your name for the record, and please proceed.
Good morning, chairs and conference committee members. My name is Willie Jett, and I'm the Commissioner of Education. In the spirit of collaborative decision making, I want to convey my heartfelt thanks on behalf of Governor, Lieutenant Governor, the MDE team, and myself for the invitation to provide some thoughts to the committee in this first hearing. It is extremely important to recognize the hard work put in this session by all members here in the education committees and by staff and advocates. With this budget surplus and the resulting education target of close to $5.5 billion provided by leadership, you are presented with a historic opportunity to make transformational investments in our education system. You have also been presented a unique opportunity to consider a range of policy solutions that have unfortunately been denied or ignored due to political division for almost a decade, and that respond to many needs that have arisen in the last decade of significant change and challenge. Thank you for lifting up the voices of our students, our families, educators, schools, and community members this session. And thank you for hearing those voices and rolling up your sleeves and diving into the work of finding the solutions that they need and deserve. So many of the investments and policy in the House and Senate bills in front of the conference committee are focused on what matters to our students. The bills provide the funding for the fundamental building blocks of school finance, so schools have the resources to provide an excellent teaching and learning environment to all students. The bills target resources at and create policy advances for academic, mental health, behavioral, and wraparound supports that our students and their families need and deserve. Our educators are the bedrock of our education system. The legislation in front of the conference committee includes not only our teachers and administrators, but also our specialists and support staff. The proposals meet the workforce challenges we have head on. And this budget recognizes the crucial role that MTE plays in our education ecosystem by providing much needed resources and funding for critical programs and operations. On behalf of Governor Walz, Lieutenant Governor Flanagan, and the team at MDE, thank you for including so many of the proposals from the governor's education budget and policy bills. This alignment with the Due North Education Plan puts Minnesota on a path where every child receives a high-quality education, no matter their race or zip code. The progress we can make on this plan this session alone is monumental. One of the main reasons this conference committee can take advantage of the historic opportunity in front of us with this surplus is because for the first time in a very long time, it is an unrestricted effort at putting serious funding toward our most fundamental formulas that are the lifeblood for programming, operations, contracts, and required services for students' diverse needs. Since we are near the end of this historic legislative session, I want to be frank on where the governor, lieutenant governor, and I stand on some of the differences between the House and the Senate. We must be honest and among partners and friends. I strongly encourage the conference committee to adopt the House's position and match the governor's investment on the general education formula by not only increasing the formula by 4% in 2024 and 2% in 2025, but finally linking the formula to inflation. Linking to inflation is a game changer that starts to provide hope that the system has an automatic lever built in, one that should not be at the whim of politics, that will also allow districts and charters to more confidently budget and educators to more securely plan for the next year. For too long, schools have been meeting the needs of our students receiving special education services without the necessary dedicated funding. This budget makes a significant dent in that underfunding. Thank you to both bodies for making a monumental investment in the special education cross-subsidy, which relieves pressures on operating budgets, thereby benefiting all students. I also want to highlight the inclusion of several targeted special education investments that will make a significant difference in the lives of our children and educators and quality of our schools. Funding services for students receiving special education services until age 22, to match federal law, providing extra funding for intermediates and co-ops with settings 4 and higher, assuring young students receive early childhood special education services in VPK rooms and have breakfast and English learner services paid for. Excuse me. And eliminating the disparities in hours of instruction for kindergartners with a disability. I am confident that this year we will finally make those 4,000 expiring VPK seats permanent. This will provide some stability and access to high-quality programming in the early childhood space, which can significantly impact our littlest ones' life trajectory for the better. But I believe we can and should invest even higher in this early childhood programming. While I'm extremely appreciative that the House funds an additional 5,200 VPK seats, I strongly encourage the conference committee to also increase the average daily membership for these seats to 1.0. An investment that will provide full day, high quality programming for these students and alleviate the complexity of braiding different funding streams to make VPK as effective as possible. I also appreciate the importance placed on specific needs of our students who have been the most underserved year after year. I'm happy to see funding for English learners included. Far too long, this funding formula has remained flat. With a growing number of English learner families coming to Minnesota every year, we must come together to make the investments to provide their children with the opportunities they deserve. I would like to continue working with the committee on the best formula for this investment. Thank you for providing the governor and lieutenant governor's proposed funding amount for American Indian Education Aid. Our American Indian students have so much to offer, and yet they have been so underserved. This funding dedicated to American Indian student outcomes and the achievement is critical to the success of American Indian communities as well. Paired with the investment in Native language revitalization grants and all the policy proposals in both bodies' bills, this legislative session will be monumentous for our American Indian students. Bless you to whoever that was. The inclusion of all past due proposals for American Indian education is critical. From honoring students' right to wear items of cultural significance at graduation ceremonies, banning mascots depicting American Indians, and creating Indigenous Peoples Day, to empowering American Indian parent advisory committees, allowing data sharing with tribal nations, and using the state count of American Indian students. All of these take the necessary steps towards supporting some of our most underserved students. Everyone in this room cares about the academic outcomes of our students. That's why we're here. That's the game. These bills make investments in programs and supports our students need to succeed, and policy changes that create a more inclusive teaching and learning environment, a critical component of academic success. So I also want to thank you for including many of the components of the READ Act bold literacy proposals. These investments and policy changes will create a more robust and targeted system focused on evidence-based literacy outcomes. My team commits to continuing to work with the conference committee on enhancing these investments to cover more areas like data analysis and finding more ways to fund these initiatives on an ongoing basis. Thanks for inclusion of funding for our multi-tiered systems of support, or MTSS, and Compass initiatives. This programming will allow districts and charters to build capacity to meet the academic, behavioral, developmental, social, and emotional needs of all students. This proposal continues its focus on supporting core academic outcomes. For this, too, we commit to working with you to find more robust ongoing funding for this much-needed initiative. Just like making sure that all students have access to nutritious meals is a critical building block to academic success, so, too, is creating a safe and welcoming environment. This requires providing programs and supports where students see themselves in their education and feel protected. Thank you for addressing the need for ethnic studies and Indigenous education for all in our academic standards, while allowing students flexibility in their schedules to pursue their academic interests. We know that every minute that students miss ed instruction has a detrimental impact on their learning and subsequent achievement. This is why proposing next generation alternatives to exclusion is critical to the academic, mental, behavioral, and social emotional trajectories of our young learners' lives. And bless you to that person too. The implementation of system-wide non-exclusionary discipline practices, a package the department has proposed for several years, is paramount to keeping students in the school setting and committing to their success and closing the achievement gap. My team has been working with a range of advocates to find agreeable solutions where they can be found. This policy language works in tandem with investments proposed by the governor and lieutenant governor to support professional development in non-exclusionary discipline practices, alternatives to suspension, and model discipline policies. I encourage the conference committee to adopt both the budget and policy components for the best outcomes for our students. Contributing resources to the wraparound services and enrichment opportunities for our families and children will make more of our schools the community hubs they aspire to be. So thank you for targeted investments in full service community schools and after school learning grants. Making sure that our educators are supported and valued and that our schools have the resources to recruit and retain high quality and diverse workforce is fundamental to the world-class education we must provide to our students here in Minnesota. So thank you to both bodies for providing ongoing funding for Grow Your Own programs to diversify the teacher workforce. We know that students learn better when they see themselves in the adults who work with them every day. And so Minnesota needs to be better here, and this bill invests in Grow Your Own programs that are in high demand and that work. We also know that our students have various needs that support personnel in our schools can meet. We also know that Minnesota has some of the worst student to support personnel ratios in the country. We just lack the dedicated resources to hire support personnel like years in the past with psychologists, social workers, counselors, and chemical dependency counselors. The governor, House, Senate have proposed funding for these much needed professionals as well as viable solutions for creating a workforce pipeline for our support personnel. As mentioned before, our support staff, many hourly workers, are critical to the functioning and success of our schools. However, staying in those positions is many times untenable when summer hours drop off and they are barred from collecting unemployment insurance. By removing the prohibition on these workers accessing unemployment insurance, we remove another barrier for people staying in the public education sector. I understand the monumental task of putting the budget together and the pressure it placed on funding in this area. Finally, just thank you for funding so many other supports at MDE, including operations, equity, diversity, and inclusion staff, the Office of Inspector General, Audit and Internal Controls Team, EdFi, and litigation costs. And so one last time, thank you for the opportunity to offer support, these supportive comments through the lens of collaboration. We look forward to collaborating with you on this historic package as we move forward on behalf of our students, families, educators, schools, and community. The final product will be one you and your colleagues can send the governor for his signature, and one we can all be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Jett, and thank you for all your work and your focus on our students. With that, as a reminder, folks, the spreadsheets of the side-by-sides and summaries are posted on the House Education Finance website. With that, we are going to move over to a walkthrough of the spreadsheets with this our fiscal analysts, Solveig Beckel from the House and Jenna Hofer from the Senate. Please go for it. Did you want to go in the front there and then, or sit at the table? Why don't we go in the front? I'll make a decision. We'll go in the front. And then make sure you just state your name for the record, and I know you're going to be switching off too as well. So I will leave it in your very capable hands. I don't know what it says, too, that both our fiscal analysts are wearing green for money. So this is a good vibe at the beginning of the committee meeting. So proceed, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Solveig Beckel, House Fiscal.
Madam Chair and committee members, my name is Jenna Hofer. I'm the Senate Fiscal Analyst.
Thank you. And definitely coordinated this, Madam Chair. So we are going to be going through the change-only spreadsheet. So that is the updated date is 4/29/2023, 11:56 a.m. That's in the top right-hand corner. So in the top left-hand corner, 2023 Legislature, K-12 Education Finance Omnibus. And I'm going to briefly explain a little bit about the spreadsheet just for your understanding. So going from left to right here to explain the columns, there's the line number, hopefully self-explanatory, the program. So these items are change items only. So if you'd like to see the base funding, you can refer to the full spreadsheet, which has the timestamp of 11:50 a.m. Then columns A through G are the House position, and then columns H through O are the Senate position, with the exception of L. L and P are the difference between the House and Senate position, and that's just shown with the House minus the Senate. So if you see a negative number there, that means the House is lower. And if you see a positive number there, it means the House is higher. Then if you see, depending on whether you have a color copy or not, if you see bright yellow shading over the Senate side, or just gray shading over the Senate side, it means that there is a difference between the House and Senate position. So. Now I'm going to go ahead and start going through that spreadsheet. All right, so line 4 just shows the formula allowance. As you can see, looking at the Senate side, the fiscal year 24 number, the formula allowance proposal is the same for each body, but then it changes in fiscal year 25. On line number 5, you can see the dollar amount increase that would be proposed by the percent increase, which is what you've typically heard about. So on line 6, it shows that percent increase. The House proposes a 4% in fiscal year 24 increase and a 2% in fiscal year 25 increase. And then in fiscal years 26 and 27, proposes linking the formula to inflation. Whereas the Senate proposes a 4% increase in 24, which is the same as the House, but then diverges and proposes a 5% increase in fiscal year 25, and then no increase in fiscal years 26 and 27. Line 7 is just showing the age shift percentage, which is typically 90% and 10%. Okay, then moving down to the change items. Line 9 is the adjusted daily membership change for children with disabilities. The House and Senate are the same on this proposal. This has a cost of $140,000 in fiscal years 24 and 25 and $152,000 in the TALES. Line 10, English learner aid for early childhood special education students. This is the same for the House and Senate. This has a cost of $1.083 million in the first biennium and $1.385 million in the second biennium. Line 11, English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid, and this is just the increase to that. These are different in the House and Senate. The House proposes $81.77 million in the first biennium and $272.015 million in the second biennium. The Senate proposes $96.942 million in the first biennium and $224,586,000 in the second biennium. And you can see that that's a difference of $15.172 million in the first biennium, that the House is less, and $47.429 million in the second biennium, that the House is more. Line 12, this is also a difference in the proposals. This is compensatory revenue formula change. So there is no difference in the first biennium, but then the House proposes increased revenue for the compensatory revenue of $20.658 million in the second biennium, and the Senate does not have this proposal. Line 13 is from the universal meals proposal the universal meals chapter 18 that has already gone into effect. We've decided to show this on the spreadsheet because this was signed into law after the February forecast. So we just wanted to show this impact since it related to the Education Finance Committee. But as you can see, it is in brackets, so it does not impact your target. Line 14, this is also a House-only provision. Extended time revenue for residential treatment facilities. This has a cost of $1.283 million in the first biennium and $1.395 million in the second biennium. Line 15, the general education formula allowance increase. So this is the cost of the 4 and 2 in inflation for the House and 4 and 5 for the Senate. Of course, these numbers are different. So the cost for the House is $704,996,000 in the first biennium and $1.344369 billion in the second biennium. For the Senate, the cost is $912,642,000 in the first biennium and $1.351451 billion in the second biennium. And you can see the differences in columns L and P. Line 16 is just sort of a header for lines 17, 18, and 19. These are interactions with the general education formula and other proposals. So if the general education, if the gen ed formula is increased and these other items happen, then more money will also be increased and will have to be paid out. So the House and Senate both have all of these proposals, but at different levels because they propose different levels of spending for all of these items. So for the interaction between English learner aid for early childhood special education students and English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid, the House has a cost of $912,000 in the first biennium and $2.171 million in the second biennium. The Senate has a cost of $357,000 in the first biennium and $457,000 in the second biennium. For pre-K and the basic formula increase interaction, the House has a cost of $4.886 million in the first biennium and $14.596 million in the second biennium. The Senate has a cost of $1.943 million in the first biennium and $2.904 million in the second biennium. For the pre-K and English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid cost in the interaction, the House has a cost of $2.778 million in the first biennium and $19.213 million in the second biennium. The Senate has a cost of $552,000 in the first biennium and $575,000 in the second biennium. Moving down to line 20, this gets to the levy neutralization or levy equalization. This just means the House paying for any levy, the House and Senate, excuse me, paying for any levy impacts that the bill created. So the House has broken out each separate levy proposal, but the Senate did this slightly differently. So they just combined all of their proposals into one levy line. But line 20, the levy equalization for the long-term facilities maintenance joint powers levy changes. The House has a cost of $1.96 million in the first biennium and $3.92 million in the second biennium. And the Senate does have this proposal as well. It's just rounded into line 24, the Senate's levy offset line, because they tracked it slightly differently. Line 21, the Senate has this provision, but not the same cost, because there was slight tracking differences. So this is the levy equalization for the Moorhead and Fergus Falls long-term facilities maintenance HVAC. Proposal, and so this has a cost of $420,000 in the first biennium and $840,000 in the second. Line 22, levy equalization for the special instruction extension to age 22. This has a cost of $2.036 million in the first biennium and $2.241 million in the second biennium. And then the levy equalization for pre-K. On line 23, the House is carrying a cost of $17.39 million in the first biennium and $34.85 million in the second biennium. And the Senate does have their costs for the VPK levies as well, but the Senate is proposing fewer seats for the VPK extension, so their levies are obviously going to be lower for that, which is why the Senate number on line 24 doesn't seem as high as the VPK number that the House is carrying there. So line 24, the levy Senate offset is $8.8 million in the first biennium and $13.088 million in the second biennium. Line 25 and line 26 are very similar. Both the House and the Senate have a proposal for menstrual products in schools and providing operating capital to fund that, but the House added the additional component of providing naloxone, or more commonly known as Narcan, in schools to that same proposal, so we decided to break that out on two separate lines to distinguish those. So the Senate proposes for the menstrual products in schools on line 25, $3.538 million in the first biennium and $3.681 million in the second. And the House proposes very similar amounts, $3.628 million in the first biennium and $3.682 million in the second biennium. Line 27, the House and Senate are the same. Online learning aid for Bureau of Indian Education students, that's just $3,000 each year ongoing. Line 28, the pre-kindergarten program, general education aid, this is linked to the formula. The House proposes $85.285 million in the first biennium and $154.986 million in the second biennium. The House proposal includes extending the 4,000 existing seats and then also adding 5,200 additional VPK seats. So that's why those numbers seem much higher. And then the Senate proposal includes extending the 4,000 seats. And the costs for this include $31.747 million in the first biennium and $32.578 million in the second biennium. Line 29, special instruction extended to age 22. This is the general education cost. Later down in the spreadsheet, you'll also see a smaller special education cost for this same proposal. This has a general education cost of $9.641 million in the first biennium and $10.148 million in the second biennium, and the House and Senate are in alignment on this one. And then finally, for the general education basic items, the transportation sparsity revenue, this is a House-only proposal, and this has a cost of $14.011 million in the first biennium and $20.209 million in the second biennium. So the general education base subtotal for the House is $932.225 million in the first biennium of just change items, and then $1.906836 billion in the second biennium of just change items. And then for the Senate, that total is $1.067391 billion in the first biennium and $1.641011 billion in the second biennium.
Ms. Speckle, thank you. I think between sections like this, we're going to stop and ask if folks have any clarifying questions. So members, are there any clarifying questions on the spreadsheet so far? Seeing none, go ahead. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I will take the next portion of the spreadsheet here, and Ms. Beckel and I will continue to alternate and pause for breaks for questions. So members, beginning on line 33 are other general education programs. So these would be other programs within the general education article. However, they are not included within the general education aid appropriation. These are separate appropriations. On line 34 is a career and technical education grant for emergency medical services courses. In this one in particular, the House and Senate both carry the provision. However, they're carried in separate articles. The House carries this provision in the general education article, while the Senate carries it in the education excellence article. The House proposes $1 million per biennium, while the Senate proposes $2 million in the first biennium only. And then on line 35 is a House-only provision for Career and Technical Education Transportation Pilot Program. This is a one-time appropriation of $450,000 in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 36 is a Senate-only provision that would provide general education disparity aid in the amount of $56.12 million in the first biennium and $40.975 million in the tails. On line 37 is an English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid adjustment. So this impacts the LAWS 2021 provision that would provide $2 million per year in general, English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid for fiscal years 22 through 25 only. The House leaves that as is, while the Senate reduces that appropriation in fiscal years 24 and 25 and includes that instead above in the English learner cross-subsidy reduction aid. So on the Senate side, that would show as a reduction of $4 million in the first biennium only. On line 38 and 39 are two non-public pupil appropriations, and these are both related to the formula allowance increase that Ms. Beckel already described. On line 38 is the non-public pupil education aid formula allowance increase. In the House, this is an increase of $723,000 in the first biennium and $1.433 million in the tails. In the Senate, this is an increase of $942,000 in the first biennium and $1.445 million in the tails. Line 39 is the non-public pupil transportation formula allowance increase of $2.892 million in the first biennium for the House and $7.657 million in the tails. In the Senate, this increase is $3.977 million in the first biennium and $7.69 million in the tails. Line 40 is an appropriation for the Rural Career and Technical Education Consortium grants. The House proposes increasing these grants above the base amount by $4 million in the first biennium and $4 million in the tails. Line 41 is a House-only provision that would provide transportation funding for students to and from area learning center programs. This is an appropriation of $2 million in the first biennium and $2 million in the tails. And on line 42, we forgot to remove this line, actually, so there's no funding on that line specifically. It does allude to the unemployment insurance aid, which we'll discuss further down the spreadsheet. But members, on line 43 is the total, the subtotal for the other general education programs. In the House, this would be an increase of $11.065 million in the first biennium and $16.09 million in the tails. On the Senate side, it's an increase of $59.039 million in the first biennium and $50.11 million in the tails. And we'll pause for questions.
Members, are there any clarifying questions on this portion of the spreadsheet? Seeing none, go ahead.
Okay, moving on to education excellence. Line 48 shows the formula allowance increase for the pre-K for achievement and integration aid. This has a cost of $630,000 in the first biennium and $1.013 million in the tails for the House. It has a cost of $352,000 in the first biennium and $381,000 in the tails for the Senate. Line 49 is a Senate-only proposal for the Alliance of Chicanos, Hispanics, and Latin Americans. This has a cost of $500,000 in the first biennium only. Line 50 is for the Building Assets Reducing Risk Center, and this funding would be available until June 30th, 2026. Both the House and Senate fund this proposal at $5 million in fiscal year 2024. Line 51, this is, again, the formula allowance increase for charter school building lease aid for pre-K. The House funds this at $1.03 million in the first biennium and $1.737 million in the tails. The Senate funds this at $433,000 in the first biennium and $443,000 in the tails. Lines 52 and 53 are part of the same House-only proposal. It's Computer Science Education Advancement and Computer Science STEAM grants. Line 52, the Computer Science Education Advancement receives $1 million in both biennia. Line 53, same thing, the Computer Science STEAM grants receives $1 million each biennium. Line 54, both the House and Senate have this proposal, but it's funded at slightly different levels. The Educational Outcome and Accountability Pilot, in the House proposal, it receives $180,000 in the first biennium only, and in the Senate proposal, it receives $300,000 in the first biennium only. Lines 55 and 56 is the House Ethnic Studies proposal. Line 55 is the Ethnic Studies Community Consultation Grants. This is funded at $300,000 in each biennium. And line 56, the Ethnic Studies Grants. This is funded at $1.4 million each biennium. Line 57, Full Service Community Schools. Both the House and Senate have this in their proposals. The House funds this at $22.416 million in the first biennium and $16.309 million in the second biennium. And the Senate funds this at $14.5 million in fiscal year 24, but this is available through the end of fiscal year 2027. Line 58 is the Genocide and Holocaust Education Requirement. This is in the House provision, or in the House bill only. This has a. This is funded at $150,000 per biennium ongoing. Line 59, this is the same in both the House and Senate. It receives $1.5 million in fiscal year 24. Line 60 is the Innovative Service Learning Grants. This is a Senate-only proposal, and it receives $1 million in fiscal year 24. Line 61, this is also a Senate-only proposal, Junior Achievement North Grant. And this receives $1 million in fiscal years 24 and 25 only. Line 62, the Minnesota Alliance of Boys and Girls Clubs. So the House and Senate both have this as well, but the Senate has this proposal in a different article. They hold it in the community ed article. The House funds this proposal at $2.5 million in the first biennium only, and the Senate funds this proposal at $5 million in the first biennium only. Line 63, this is a House proposal only. This is for MAP STARS. This receives $50,000 in fiscal year 2024. Line 64, this is both the House and Senate, the Minnesota Center for the Book. The House funds this proposal at $400,000 each biennium ongoing, and the Senate funds this at $300,000 in the first biennium only. Line 65, the Minnesota Council on Economic Education. This is a Senate proposal only, and this receives $400,000 in the first biennium only. Line 66, the Minnesota Foundation for Student Organizations. This has base funding, so this is just an increase to their base funding. The House proposes increasing their base funding by $632,000 each biennium, and the Senate proposes increasing their base funding by $200,000 in the first biennium only. Line 67, the Minnesota Math Corps increase. Again, this program has base funding. The House proposes increasing that base funding by $1 million per biennium, and the Senate proposes increasing that base funding by $1 million in the first biennium only. Line 68 is the COMPASS, or Multi-Tiered Systems of Support Program. The House proposes funding for this item at $36.5 million over the course of the biennium, and this is broken out by the Center for Applied Research and Educational Improvement. Yes. I apologize. As well as grants to schools, Minnesota Department of Education and Service Cooperatives Implementation, and Regional Math Network and Summer Math Institute. And again, it receives $36.5 million in the House proposal. The Senate proposes funding it in both biennia, and the Senate has funding for it at $7.488 million in the first biennium and $24.4 million in the second biennium. Line 73 is a Senate-only proposal. Museums and education centers receive base funding, but the Senate proposes increasing that base funding by $1.562 million in the first biennium and $2.562 million in the second biennium. Line 74 is a House-only proposal. The House proposes funding the non-exclusionary discipline provisions at $3.5 million per biennium ongoing. Line 75 is a Senate-only proposal for online music instruction grants. The Senate proposes funding these at $300,000 in fiscal year 24. Line 76 is for paraprofessional paid orientation. Both the House and Senate have this provision, but it does exist in different articles. The House is in education excellence, but it is in the special education article in the Senate. The House funds this at $15.869 million in the first biennium and $16.672 million in the second. The Senate funds this at $14.105 million in the first biennium, though it does start the funding for this program in fiscal year 25 because it is in the special education article, and then $32.453 million in the second biennium. Line 77 is a House provision only. The House proposes funding the Sene Foundation at $3 million per biennium ongoing. And finally, line 78, the Walkabouts Program grants. This is in the Senate only, and this receives $500,000 in the first biennium only. And Madam Chair, that's the Education Excellence article.
Thank you, members. Senator McQuaid.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And this might be a question for members of the conference committee. It might be a question for staff. But there are a few pieces that came through that were in our education policy bill. And so I understand what they are in policy, but I'm not 100% sure what they are in funding. Those two pieces so far are the genocide Holocaust education requirement and the non-exclusionary discipline. Can you just explain what those funding pieces are?
Should I could explain them, or should I go to Solve, Ms. Beckel?
Thank you, Madam Chair. So in discussing those items, I simply laid out the funding levels that the House had for those items. I can't speak to what policy was in the Senate. I could try to, but I would defer to my Senate colleagues to discuss that.
Ms. Hofer.
Madam Chair and committee members, thank you for the question. Senator McQuaid, to your question, I believe essentially the difference here is the Senate and House both carried policy provisions, and the House provided some funding to go along with those provisions to assist with implementation and administrative costs would be my understanding on the genocide and Holocaust education requirement, and then on the the non-exclusionary discipline practices. I believe on the House side, those would be grants. Is that correct? Grants for non-exclusionary discipline practices.
Senator McQuaid.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Grants for what? Which I think that's great. I carried one of the bills, but I just want to know grants for what, and then for and then who are they going to? Are they going to, like, pilot in different schools, or are they to the department? And same for the Holocaust genocide implementation. Is that to the department? Is that to districts?
Thank you. Ms. Parra, please introduce yourself for the record and proceed.
Madam Chair, members, my name is Christina Parra. I work with Nonpartisan House Research. Senator McQuaid, I can point you to the language in the House bill, and it's in Article 2, page R91 of the A2. So at the very bottom of that page is where the grant language for the non-exclusionary discipline begins, and it is for grants to school districts and charter schools to provide training for staff on non-exclusionary disciplinary practices. And it goes on to say it's to develop training and work with schools to train staff on non-exclusionary disciplinary practices that maintain the respect, trust, and attention of students and help keep students in the classroom. So that is the non-exclusionary discipline grant language. And let me see if I can pull up the... and then on page R87 of the side-by-side, the House language for the is for the implementation of education on the Holocaust, genocide of Indigenous peoples, and other genocides, and that is $75,000 that goes to the department to implement the requirements of that section.
Thank you, Representative McQuaid. Did you have a follow-up?
No, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else have any clarifying questions? Seeing none, please proceed.
Madam Chair and committee members, thank you. The next article that we will look at is the READ Act, which begins on line 81. Line 82 is similar in the House and Senate bills. Both provide funding for a contract with CARI, and the House provides $4.2 million in the first biennium only, while the Senate provides $8.4 million in the first biennium. Line 83 is a House-only provision, which would provide funding for curriculum and instructional materials. This is $40 million in fiscal year 2024 only, though you'll notice that there are asterisk marks next to that item, which indicates that the funding for this appropriation is available through June 30th of 2028. On line 84, both the House and the Senate are aligned on the provision to provide a literacy specialist at the Department of Education. Both proposals would provide $500,000 in each biennium for a literacy specialist. Line 85 is similar in the House and Senate. This is a provision that would provide funds for professional development to implement the REIT Act. So the House would provide $27.45 million in the first biennium and $6 million in the tails. And you can see on lines 86 through 88 how this funding is broken out. So that would be $250,000 in fiscal year 2024 only for the Department of Education's administrative costs. Line 87 is funding for the Regional Literacy Networks of $18 million in fiscal year 2024, and then in the tails, it would be $6 million. And on line 88 would be funding for statewide training, and this is $9.2 million in fiscal year 2024 only. And again, the funding in fiscal year 2024 is available through fiscal year 2028. On the Senate side, the Senate provides $32.543 million in the first biennium and $14.4 million in the tails for this professional development. And the Senate has only indicated where the funding will go for the first biennium. On line 86, you can see there's $125,000 for the Department for Administrative Costs. On line 87,
apologies, getting used to the microphones over here in the House. Line 87 is funding of $18 million in fiscal year 2024 only for regional literacy networks. And then on line 88 is funding in fiscal year 2024 only of $9.2 million for the statewide training. Line 89 is a House-only provision that would provide subs and incentives for teacher training of $1 million in the first biennium only. I think this might be an error on our spreadsheet. There's bracketed funding in the Senate for that as well. We'll look into that one. So then the REIT Act total on line 90 is $73.15 million in the House for the first biennium and $6.5 million in the tails. On the Senate side, it's $41.4 million in the first biennium and $14.9 million in the tails.
Thank you, members. Any clarifying questions on this portion of the spreadsheet? Seeing none, go ahead and proceed.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So the next article is the American Indian Education article, line 92. So line 93 is the American Indian Education Aid increase. So this is part, this is just part of that article. Online, and both the House and Senate have the same proposal. So the increase for fiscal years 24 and 25 is $12.974 million. And the increase for the tails is $14.751 million. Line 94, both the House and Senate have this in some way, the American Indian Teacher Training Program Modification. The House proposes an increase of $1.610 million in fiscal year 24 and proposes transferring this to the Special Revenue Fund and allowing use of funds out of the Special Revenue Fund, so funds effectively would not then cancel out of this fund like they do from the general fund if they are unused. The Senate proposes increasing funding to this of $200,000 each biennium, but the Senate does not put this into the Special Revenue Fund. Line 95, the Native Language Revitalization Grants. The House and Senate are in alignment on this one as well. And this, the proposed increase is $15 million in the first biennium and the second biennium. Line 96, the Tribal Contract Schools Formula Allowance Increase. So this is just tied to the formula increases. The cost for this is $531,000 in the first biennium and $1.023 million in the second biennium for the House. And in the Senate, it is $688,000 in the first biennium and $1.036 million in the second biennium. And that is the American Indian Education article.
Thank you. Members, any clarifying questions on this section? Seeing none, proceed.
Madam Chair and committee members, the next article is the teachers article, which begins on line 99. In this section, you will see that it's broken out into two different sections. The first is for grants and aids administered by the Department of Education. And the second section is grants that are administered by the Professional Educator Licensing and Standards Board, or PELSB. On line 101 is an increase to the Alternative Teacher Compensation Aid Program, or QCOMP, and this is related to the pre-kindergarten proposals by the House and Senate. And because the amounts of increase for those programs were different in the House and Senate, you'll see slightly different amounts in each budget. On the House side, it's an increase of $1.662 million in the first biennium and $2.923 million in the tails, while the Senate would propose an increase of $651,000 in the first biennium and $686,000 in the tails. On line 102 is a House-only provision that would provide a grant to the Black Men Teach program. This is $1 million per biennium. Line 103 is a Senate-only provision. The Senate proposes providing a grant for closing educational opportunity gaps. This is $8 million per biennium. Line 104 is a Senate-only provision that would provide funding to the Coalition to Increase the Teachers of Color and American Indian Teachers, or TOCATE. This is $200,000 per biennium. On line 105, is the Come Teach in Minnesota program. There are some adjustments in both the House and the Senate. The House would reduce the existing appropriation base for fiscal year 2024 by $200,000. And then the base, the February forecast base for fiscal years 2025 and later would remain the same. In the Senate proposes increasing funding for the program beginning in fiscal year 2025. So that would be an increase of $200,000 for the first biennium and $400,000 in the tails. On line 106 is the Grow Your Own program. Both the House and Senate provide increases to this program, and both would transfer these funds to the Special Revenue Fund as is current law. In the House, there's a proposal for an increase of $34 million per biennium, while the Senate proposes an increase of $49 million per biennium. On line 107 is a House-only provision that would provide licensure shortage areas and special education teacher pipeline grants, and this is related to the Grow Your Own program, but I believe it's a separate program in the House. And this would be a new program, so that would be $20 million per biennium. Line 108 is a Senate-only proposal for the statewide teacher mentoring program. This is $9.94 million in fiscal year 2024 only, and this appropriation is available through fiscal year 2027. Line 109 is a proposal that is similar in the House and Senate. This is a proposal that would provide student support personnel aid. The House proposes providing $75 million in the first biennium and $150 million in the tails, while the Senate proposes $49.422 million in the first biennium and $99.177 million in the tails. Line 110 is a on the spreadsheet that's shown here as a Senate-only provision, but in the House, they do carry a related provision. It's just in the state agencies article, so we'll get to that momentarily. The Senate would provide funding for a mental health lead at the Department of Education, and this is $300,000 per biennium. On line 111 is a proposal that's similar in the House and Senate. Both would provide funding for student support personnel workforce pipelines. The House would provide $10 million per biennium, while the Senate provides $4.8 million per biennium. Line 112 is a Senate-only provision. This is related to teacher licensure and exam fees. The Senate would reimburse those fees for 3 years. This appropriation is available through fiscal year 2027. This is an appropriation of $1.4 million in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 113 is a House-only proposal for the teacher residency program, and this is $6 million per biennium. Line 114, we begin the Pelsby grants. On line 115 is a House-only proposal that would provide alternative pathways to licensure. This is a support position at the Professional Educator Licensing and Standards Board. This is $300,000 per biennium. Line 116 is funding to Pelsby for administrative costs related to removing barriers to teacher licensure. This is $77,000 in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 117, both the House and Senate propose increasing funding for the Collaborative Urban and Greater Minnesota Educators of Color, or CUGMEC, grant. The House proposes increasing funding by $10 million per biennium, while the Senate proposes increasing funding by $8.88 million in the first biennium and $8.7 million in the tails. Line 118, there is alignment here between the House and Senate. Both would provide funding for heritage language and culture teachers. This is $416,000 per biennium. On line 119 is a House-only provision. This would provide funding to Pelsby for a licensure via portfolio online platform. So this is for some technology costs related to that. So that would be $300,000 per biennium. On line 120 is another House-only proposal. This would be grants for licensure pathway preparation. This is $800,000 per biennium. On line 121 is a proposal in the House only. This is for the Pelsby board membership and stipends for substitute teachers for the board membership. This is $134,000 per biennium. On line 122 is a similar proposal in the House and Senate. The House would provide $120,000 per biennium for reports on increasing the number of teachers of color and American Indian teachers, while the Senate would provide $20,000 in fiscal year 2024 only. And on line 123, both the House and Senate propose increases to the Teachers of Color Mentoring and Retention Grants. The House proposes an increase of $1.008 million in the first biennium, while the House proposes $3.008 million in the tails. The Senate proposes $1 million in the first biennium and $1 million in the tails. And finally, on line 124, there is alignment here between the House and Senate. Both provide an increase to Pelsby for the teacher recruitment marketing campaign. This would be $500,000 per biennium. And we'll pause there for questions.
Thank you. Did you want to go through the teacher subtotal then, or?
We certainly can.
Thank you.
Line 125, the subtotal increase for the House is $161.117 million in the first biennium, and in the tails, it's $239.501 million. In the Senate, the increase is $134.729 million in the first biennium and $173.179 million in the tails. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for going over the teacher's article. I know it's a long one. Any clarifying questions on the teacher's article? Seeing none, please proceed.
The next article is on line 127, special education. So line 128 is the separate sites and programs aid. So this is mental health aid for settings 4 and higher. Both the House and Senate have this at the same dollar amounts. So this is funded at $9.461 million in the first biennium and $10.941 million in the tails. Line 129 is a House-only provision. It is the special education due process preparation time for special education teachers. This is funded at $50.028 million in the first biennium and $35.370 million in the tails. Line 130 is the Registry of Interpreters for the Deaf, or RID, Certified Interpreters provision. The House and Senate both have this item, and it is funded at $268,000 in the first biennium and $610,000 in the tails. Line 131 is special education cross-subsidy reduction aid. Both the House and the Senate, of course, have this. And this is funded at $729,863,000 in the first biennium for the House and $843,726,000 in the tails for the House. In the Senate, it receives funding of $653,621,000 in the first biennium and $1,077,511,000 in the tails. Getting to be big numbers here. Line 132 is the special education homeless student transportation provision. So this is a House-only provision. It receives $2.477 million in the first biennium and $2.980 million in the tails. Line 133 is the special education foster student transportation provision, and this is the same in both the House and Senate, and it receives $519,000 in the first biennium and $1.204 million in the tails. Line 134 is the special education part of the earlier item I mentioned in general education, the special instruction extended to age 22. So there was the general education part. This is the special education part. So this item is just $34,000 in the first biennium and $78,000 in the second biennium. So the larger chunk of the cost of that provision was in the general education formula. Line 135 is another pre-K funding item. So this is the pre-K special education cost. For the House, that cost is $2.954 million in the first biennium and $5.421 million in the tails. For the Senate, the cost is $1.089 million in the first biennium and $1.187 million in the tails. And then the special education subtotal for the House in the first biennium is $795,604,000. And then in the second biennium is $900,330,000. For the Senate, the subtotal in the first biennium is $664,992,000. And then in the second biennium for the Senate, that's $1,091,531,000. And that's special education.
Thank you. Members, any clarification on this article section? Seeing none, go ahead and proceed.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. The next article is the facilities article, beginning on line 138. On line 139 is a House-only proposal for building and cybersecurity grants. This is $35 million in fiscal year 2024 only, and this appropriation would be available through fiscal year 2027. Line 140 is a House-only proposal that would provide grants for gender-neutral bathrooms. This is $2 million per biennium. Line 141 is a Senate-only proposal for historic school building preservation grants. This is $800,000 in the first biennium and $3 million in the tails. On line 142 is another component of the pre-K proposals. This one is related to the long-term facilities maintenance equalization aid program. In the House, this would be an increase of $596,000 in the first biennium and $1.051 million in the tails. In the Senate, this would be an increase of $245,000 in the first biennium and $250,000 in the tails. On line 143 is the facilities subtotal. In the House, it's an increase of $37.596 million in the first biennium and $3.051 million in the tails. In the Senate, it would be an increase of $1.045 million in the first biennium and $3.25 million in the tails.
Thank you. Any clarifying questions on this section? Seeing none, proceed, please.
The next article is nutrition. So line 146, you'll see breakfast aid for early childhood special education students. purpose is the same in the House and Senate, and it's funded at $158,000 in the first biennium and $158,000 in the tails. Line 147 is the school breakfast cost for the pre-K proposals. The House funds this at $857,000 in the first biennium and $1.51 million in the tails. The Senate funds this at $204,000 in the first biennium and in the tails. Line 148 just shows the cost for the school breakfast for universal school meals. Line 149 shows the pre-K costs for school lunch. The House funds this at $286,000 in the first biennium and $504,000 in the tails. And the Senate funds this at $68,000 in both biennia. Line 150 just shows the universal school meals costs for lunch. Then the subtotals for nutrition for the House and Senate. For the House, it is $1.301 million in the first biennium and $2.172 million in the tails. For the Senate, it's $430,000 in the first biennium and in the tails. And that's nutrition.
Thank you. Members, are there any clarifying questions on this section? Seeing none, go ahead and proceed. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. On line 53 begins the library's appropriations. On line 154, both the House and Senate propose increasing basic system support to the regional libraries. The House proposes an increase of $4.18 million in the first biennium and $4.4 million in the tails, while the Senate proposes an increase of $8 million per biennium. Line 155 is a Senate-only proposal. This would be a proposal to provide a grant to the multi-county, multi-type libraries for licensed library media specialists. This is a one-time appropriation of $1 million in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 156, both the House and Senate propose increasing the aid to multi-county, multi-type libraries. The House proposes an increase of $285,000 in the first biennium and $300,000 in the tails, while the Senate proposes an increase of $1.4 million per biennium. Line 157 is a Senate-only proposal to provide aid to school districts and charter schools for library purposes. The Senate proposes funding of $59.273 million in the first biennium and $62.373 million in the tails. Line 158 is the subtotal for library appropriations. In the House, this is an increase of $4.465 million in the first biennium and $4.7 million in the tails. In the Senate, it's an increase of $69.673 million in the first biennium and $71.773 million in the tails. I'll go through just the next couple of lines real quick before we pause for questions. On line 160, you see the general education total for each House and Senate proposal. In the House, the proposed increase is $943.29 million in the first biennium and $1.922 billion in the tails, while in the Senate, it would be an increase of $1.126 billion in the first biennium and $1.691 billion in the tails. For the other categorical totals on line 161, so these would be all of the articles that we've gone through except for general education, the House proposes an increase of $1.201 billion in the first biennium and $1.235 billion in the tails, while the Senate proposes an increase of $996.614 million in the first biennium and $1.446 billion in the tails. So the subtotal for K-12 education aides on line 162 for the House is $2.144 billion in the first biennium and $3.158 billion in the tails. On the Senate side, it's $2.123 billion in the first biennium and $3.137 billion in the tails.
Thank you. Members, any clarifying questions? Senator Duck?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate it. I can't tell, based on the spreadsheet, which of the two chairs was a library media specialist. Could you mind answering that for me? Just kidding, of course.
I'm Senator McQuaid.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And similarly, I was wondering if maybe you were like a cybersecurity expert, but I wonder if that wasn't something we heard in the Senate, and I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that provision and what that money is for and just how it works.
Thank you. I can toss it to nonpartisan staff who would like to speak to it. We brought it over from the governor's office, and I never know if I should just explain it or if I should have. Nonpartisan staff is telling me to go ahead. So this is a provision to help schools have grants for both cybersecurity and building security that we brought over from the governor's office because we thought it was important. And what is also important about it is it adds charter schools can also access those funds. Senator McQuaid.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'll just ask my what I'm sure would be the follow-up questions. One, if nonpartisan staff can refer me to the R page number so I can look at the language. And then two, what was it expected to cover? Like how many schools, or is it all the schools, and just kind of, is it a competitive grant process? Just kind of the details on that.
Great, thank you. And thank you for asking questions because that's what this is for, right? So I am gonna toss it over to nonpartisan staff. Who'd ever like to answer, please state your name for the record and proceed.
Madam Chair, members, Tim Strom from House Research. In the side-by-sides, each of the articles is listed with an R page number, and so you'll want to make sure you're in the right article, but it is page R14 of Article 8, and be on the left side where the House language is. So if you turn to Article 8, page R14 of the side-by-side, that language is in Section 18. And you can see there's relatively limited language there surrounding the grant. It's done as a grant project. And so that's where the language is there. And then there is Safe Schools language earlier in the bill that talks about the cybersecurity activities. And that begins on page R11. And you, there's some reformatting of the language there. But essentially on page R12, on line 276, 14, and 15 is how the cybersecurity costs are described as they're added to the list of the other nine factors that Safe Schools revenue may be used for.
Thank you, Senator McQuaid.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I think just the last question was just when you heard this in committee, was there a number of schools or kind of a percent that could expect to get this funding with the $35 million?
Thank you, Senator McQuaid. We briefly heard in committee through the governor's bill.
Okay.
So we didn't go quite into that level of detail with testimony.
I'll ask Mr. Uni.
Thank you. Any other clarifying questions? And please feel free. I mean, that's what we're here for. All right. Not seeing any. Go ahead and proceed.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Am I too loud now?
No.
No? Okay. This is a great room for acoustics. Line 164 is early childhood and family support. The early education components of this are being conferenced separately as House File 2292 and 2372. Okay. So briefly, we did just want to mention that line 169, the early childhood family education, the Senate has that increase as part of the K through 12 budget. The House has it as part of the early education budget. So that will just be something to work out. But the Senate has this item funded at $7.152 million in the first biennium and $10.806 million in the tails. And then we'll move on to community education on 196, because the rest of early education is not in the jurisdiction of this conference committee. If you want.
Madam Chair and members, we'll next move on to the community education programs, which begin on line 196. On line 197, both the House and the Senate propose an increase to the Adults with Disabilities Program. The House proposes an increase of $1.083 million in the first biennium and $2.406 million in the tails.
The Senate proposes an increase of $2.171 million in the first biennium and $4.994 million in the tails. And I would just note that in both the House and the Senate, these increases would begin in fiscal year 2025 rather than 2024. And this is because the Adults with Disabilities Program has both an aid and a levy component. And the House and Senate both would equalize the levies on this to provide the entire increase in aid. And so that's why you would see the increase in 2025 and later. On line 198 is a similar proposal in the House and Senate. Both propose grants for after-school programming. The House proposes grant funding of $25 million in fiscal year 2024 only, and the Senate proposes funding of $40 million in fiscal year 2024 only. In both bills, the appropriation would be available through fiscal year 2027. On line 199, both the House and the Senate propose an increase to community education aid. Similar to the Adults with Disabilities Program, you'll note that this appropriation increase begins in fiscal year 2025. The House proposes an increase of $1.98 million in the first biennium and $3.96 million in the tails, while the Senate proposes an increase of $8.603 million in the first biennium and $18.52 million in the tails. On line 200, both the House and Senate propose an increase to the education partnership programs. You'll note that both bills did modify the naming conventions for this program. Under current law, they're referred to as the Tier 1 and Tier 2 grants. They are now the Neighborhood Partnerships and the Regional Neighborhood Partnership grants. So both the House and Senate propose increases to that formerly the second tier, now the Regional Neighborhood Partnership grants. The House proposes an increase of $440,000 per biennium, while the Senate proposes an increase of $3.24 million per biennium. On line 201, you'll see the subtotal for community education. The House subtotal is an increase of $28.503 million in the first biennium and $6.806 million in the tails, while the Senate proposes an increase of $54.014 million in the first biennium and $26.754 million in the tails.
Thank you. Any clarifying questions, folks, on this section? Not seeing any. Go ahead and proceed.
The next section is lifelong learning. Line 204 is a Senate-only provision. So there is the adult basic education aid the Senate proposes an increase for. The Senate proposes $3.338 million of increase in the first biennium and $5.17 million of increase in the tails. Line 205, the House and Senate are in alignment on this one. They propose $490,000 in additional funding in fiscal year 24 that is available through fiscal year 2027 for high school equivalency tests to fully fund the battery of tests. And that is it for lifelong learning increases. So the total for the House is $490,000 in the first biennium only. And then the total for the Senate for lifelong learning is $3.828 million in the first biennium and $5.17 million in the tails. And then the total for the K through 12 jurisdiction for early childhood and family support aids is $28.993 million in the first biennium and $6.806 million in the tails for the House. And in the Senate, it's $64.994 million in the first biennium and $42.73 million in the tails. And so the subtotal of community funding and K through 12 educational aids that we're up to now is $2.1734 billion in the first biennium for the House, and $3.165 billion in the tails. And then for the Senate, it's at $2.188 billion in the first biennium and $3.18 billion in the tails.
Thank you. Are there any other clarifying questions for this section? Yes, Senator Gustafson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to thank everybody again for welcoming me here. I have another conference committee that overlaps, so I didn't want you to think I was leaving because I didn't approve.
Thank you, Senator Gustafson, and safe travels. With that, we'll go on to the next section.
Madam Chair and members, beginning on line 212 are the state agency article appropriations. Line 214 begins the appropriations for the Department of Education. On line 216 is an appropriation for the athletic race and ethnicity data collection. This is a House-only proposal that would provide $180,000 in the first biennium and $130,000 in the tails. Line 217 is another House-only proposal that would provide funding to the Department for Audit and Internal Control Resources. This is $1.6 million per biennium. Line 218 is a House-only proposal to provide an operating adjustment to the Department of Education. This is $9.6 million in the first biennium and $9.9 million in the tails. Line 219 is for pre-kindergarten administration, and you'll notice that there was a budget jurisdictional difference here between the House and the Senate. The House carried just the administrative portion of funding for pre-K in the early education budget jurisdiction, while the Senate carried all of the pre-K funding in the K-12 jurisdiction. So here you'll see no increase for the House, but that's because the amount is further up. Under the early education section, you'll see that on line 191. The Senate, though, proposes funding in the state agencies article. This would be an increase of $49,000 in the first biennium and $4,000 in the tails. On line 220, both the House and the Senate are in alignment on providing funding to the Department of Education for IT costs related to the reasonable force reporting. This is $47,000 in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 221 is a Senate-only proposal to provide school health services specialist at the Department of Education. This is $300,000 per biennium. On line 222 is a House-only proposal that would provide funding to the Department of Education for rulemaking and other activities related to the specific learning disability criteria change. This is $1.146 million per biennium. On line 223 is a House-only proposal to provide administrative costs for the Department of Education related to unemployment insurance aid. This is $450,000 in the first biennium and $350,000 in the tails. On line 224 is again related to the Chapter 18 Universal School Meals law. So this would be the administrative funding related to that, which again, because the amounts are in brackets, are not counted against the targets for the House and Senate. On line 225 is a proposal that is in alignment between the House and the Senate. Both bodies would provide additional funding to the Board of School Administrators, or BOSA, for staffing and outreach. This is $128,000 per biennium in both the House and Senate proposals. Turning to page 6, on line 226, there's alignment here between the House and the Senate to provide the EdFi data collection system and data reporting funding. This is $3.204 million in the first biennium and $4.718 million in the tails. On line 227 is a House-only proposal to provide additional funding to the Department of Education for the Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion, or EDI, Center staff. This is $4 million per biennium. On line 228 is a House-only proposal to provide administrative costs to the Department of Education for Ethnic Studies. This is $300,000 per biennium. Line 229, there's alignment between the House and the Senate to adjust the litigation fees for the Department of Education. Both the House and the Senate would modify the existing appropriation in fiscal year 2022 by reducing that by $1.5 million. That funding would then be reappropriated with additional funding in fiscal year 2024 for a total of $7.5 million in fiscal year 2024 only. On line 230, is a proposal that's shown here as a House-only proposal. There is a related proposal for the Senate in the teachers article. This would be a proposal to provide a mental health services lead at the Department of Education. This is $300,000 per biennium. And on line 231, there's alignment between the House and the Senate to provide funding to the Department for the Office of the Inspector General. This is $4 million per biennium. On line 232, you'll see the Department of Education subtotal. In the House, this would be a reduction of $1.5 million in the fiscal year 2022-23 biennium. In the 24-25 biennium, it would be an increase of $32.451 million. And in the TAILS, it would be an increase of $26.656 million. In the Senate, the fiscal year 22-23 biennium would be reduced by $1.5 million. In fiscal years 24 and 25, there would be an increase of $15.228 million. And then in the TAILS, there would be an increase of $9.15 million.
Thank you. Any clarifying questions on this section, folks? Senator Duckworth.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question is regarding line 223, the unemployment insurance aid dash admin. Is that for folks that work at MDE, or is that to help administer something amongst districts? I'm just curious as to what that's for.
Ms. Beckel.
Thank you, Madam Chair and Senator. So this is for staff at the Minnesota Department of Education to administer and review review the implementation of the unemployment provisions for our unemployment insurance for hourly workers and how that's being rolled out.
Senator Duckworth.
Thank you.
Any other clarifying questions? With that, go ahead.
Next, the next agency is the Professional Educator Licensing and Standards Board, or PELSB. That's on line 234. So line 235 is the Professional Educator Licensing and Standards Board request increase. This is a Senate proposal only. The House does not fund this, but the Senate funds this at $762,000. In the first biennium and $762,000 in the second biennium. Line 236, this is the requested operating increase. The House funds this at $538,000 in the first biennium and $682,000 in the second biennium, and the Senate funds this at the same level. Line 237 shows the subtotal for PELSB. And in the House, the subtotal is $538,000 in the first biennium and $682,000 in the TAILS. And in the Senate, the subtotal is $1.3 million in the first biennium and $1.444 million in the TAILS.
Thank you. Any clarifying questions with that section, members? Proceed.
Madam Chair and members, on line 239 begin the appropriations to the Minnesota State Academies for the Deaf and Blind. On line 240, the House and Senate are in alignment on providing funding for an audiology booth and related equipment. This is a one-time appropriation of $125,000 in fiscal year 2024 only. Line 241, the House and Senate are again in alignment on providing funding for a mental health day treatment program. This is $630,000 in the first biennium and $370,000 in the TAILS. Line 242, the House and Senate are in alignment on providing an operating adjustment to the Minnesota State Academies. This would be an increase of $3.647 million in the first biennium and $4.146 million in the TAILS. On line 243, the House and Senate are again in alignment on providing funding for a safety and security technology initiative. This is $1.265 million in the first biennium and $825,000 in the TAILS. On line 244 is funding to the Minnesota State Academies to help cover their costs related to unemployment insurance for the school hourly workers that they employ. This is $642,000 per biennium in the House and $321,000 in the first biennium for the Senate and $642,000 in the Senate and its tails. On line 245 is the subtotal for the Minnesota State Academies. In the House, there's an increase of $6.309 million in the first biennium and $5.983 million in the second biennium. In the Senate, there's an increase of $5.988 million in the first biennium and $5.983 million in the tails.
Any clarifying questions on this provision? Representative Krisha.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'm wondering if I can just back up real quick. I was taking notes. Line 229, I just noticed we have the litigation fees change. What was that for? Does the Department of Ed have a specific for that?
Ms. Beckel or Mr. Strom?
Madam Chair, Representative Krisha, there's been a line item in the MDE's budget for, I think this is the third biennium now, for the costs of litigation primarily associated with the Cruz-Guzman lawsuit. Each of the previous two biennium, the amount has been appropriated, and then the unused portion is canceled back at the end of the biennium.
I'm Representative Krisha.
Thank you. And Madam Chair, and let's see, Mr. Rooney, if you could just nod, is that correct? Is that set aside for the Cruz-Guzman? Is that what the expectation is? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other clarifying questions for this section? Proceed.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The next and final agency on the spreadsheet is the Perpich Center for Arts Education on line 247. So line 248 is classroom furniture. So the Senate just combined classroom furniture and dormitory furniture into one line on theirs. So just wanted to highlight that on line 248. On line 248, the House appropriates $300,000 just for classroom furniture in fiscal year 24, and the Senate appropriates $300,000 for both classroom furniture and dormitory furniture. Line 249, dormitory furniture, the House appropriates $850,000 in fiscal year 24, and then the Senate included their funding for dormitory furniture in the above line. Line 250, the operating increase. The House and Senate are in alignment on this one. They both appropriate $1.416 million in the first biennium and $1.758 million in the tail. And then on line 251, the House and Senate have similar provisions, but not exactly the same, for unemployment insurance to fund the costs as a reimbursing employer. So the House appropriates $24,000 each year for a total of $48,000 each biennium, and the Senate starts the funding in fiscal year 25. So for $24,000 in fiscal years 24 and 25, and $48,000 in the tails. So the total for the Perpich Center is $2.614 million in the first biennium for the House and $1.806 million in the tails. And for the Senate, it is $1.74 million in the first biennium and $1.806 million in the tails. So the total amounts for total general fund K through 12 appropriations for the House is negative $1.5 million in 22-23, $2.2156 billion in fiscal years 24 and 25, $3.2 billion in the tails. And then for the Senate, it's negative $1.5 billion in fiscal years 22-23, and then $2.212 billion in fiscal year 24-25, and $3.199 billion in the tails.
Thank you. Any more clarifying questions on this section? We'll have you briefly go through the special revenue funds then.
Madam Chair and members, beginning on line 259, are transfers and appropriations out of the Special Revenue Fund. And you'll notice there are two sections here, and I'll essentially walk through those together. So on line 261, you'll see expenditure authority, and on line 269, you'll see revenues. There are a number of appropriations that Ms. Beckel and I noted earlier that are transferred to the special revenue fund. So you'll see those transfers in to the special revenue fund as revenues. So those are in the revenue section beginning on line 269 and running through line 275. Those are then spent or expended from the special revenue fund. And that expenditure cost is beginning on line 261 and running through line 267. So essentially, these end up netting out to neutral between the appropriations. So as I go through these, note that the expenditure and revenue authority looks the same for those purposes. So line 262 and line 270 are related. This is the transfer in and then the expenditure for the American Indian Teacher Prep Grants. So this would be $2.8 million in the first biennium for both for the House, and then $1.2 million for the House and the tails. The Senate did not transfer these funds to the special revenue fund. Those remain in the general fund for the Senate. On line 263 and 264, these transfers and expenditure authority are both related to appropriations that are being tracked in the early education budget. They're included here in large part because the Senate carried all of their early education program changes within House File 2497, the first unofficial engrossment. So those are shown here for those purposes only. On line 264 is the expenditure authority, and on line 272 is the revenue transfer in for the Grow Your Own Early Childhood Educators appropriation. This is, again, similar to the early learning scholarships. It's carried in the early childhood portion. Line 265 is the expenditure authority, and line 273 is the revenue transfer in for the Grow Your Own program. In the House, this would be $34 million in the first biennium and $34 million in the tails. That's transferred in and then expended from the special revenue fund. In the Senate, this would be $49 million in the first biennium and again in the tails. And on line 266, is the expenditure authority, and on line 274 is the revenue transfer in for the House-only proposal for licensure shortage areas and the special education pipeline. So this would be a transfer in and then expenditure of $20 million per biennium. So that's where you'll see then on line 267 the expenditure authority of $328.652 million in the first biennium for the House and $135.878 million in the second biennium. And then in the Senate, this would be an expenditure authority of $322.5 million in the first biennium and $122.53 million in the second biennium. And that you'll see all equals the amounts on line 275, those revenue transfers in. Line 277 then is the net total, which nets to zero in both the House and Senate for both bienniums, again, because of the revenue transfers in and then the appropriations out.
Thank you. Members, any clarifying questions on this section? I will note on line 274, that license shortage area sped pipeline, that is something that the House put in to help special education teachers, partially as a Grow Your Own program in Greater Minnesota, but more importantly, to help do grants to get tier one and two special education teachers, which are about 50% of our population right now, up to tier three quickly because of the October letter we received from the federal government. So just wanted to throw that out there.
Madam Chair, can I ask a follow-up to that?
Yes, Senator Duckworth.
Based on that letter from the federal government, I guess I was under the impression that it was sort of up to interpretation as to whether or not the state of Minnesota was compliant or not. Is it the general consensus of researchers and nonpartisan that the state is not compliant with that federal regulation?
I don't know if nonpartisan wants to answer that.
That's okay.
My understanding is that the federal government showed us the stick but didn't quite use it yet in that letter. So we want to make sure that we also have highly qualified teachers working with our most vulnerable population. So that is a big...
So if I may, this would be an attempt to help us get into alignment with that. That's
yes,
what you're saying.
Senator okay. Duckworth, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other clarification? Clarifying questions? Do we need to go on to the restricted revenue account before we close?
Finish.
Madam Chair, the only item in the restricted special revenue fund is the expenditure authority for the online learning fee. This is an online learning fee that MDE has been allowed to collect but has not had the expenditure authority to expend. So this item is the same in the House and Senate, and we anticipate that the expenditure authority would be $36,000 in the first biennium and $14,000 in the tails.
Thank you. And I want to thank Ms. Beckel, Ms. Hofer, for your work on walking us through this. I know spreadsheets can be tedious, but we all know it's very important. Members, instead of diving into the side-by-sides right now for language, since we only have about 5 minutes left, I just want to open it up one more time for clarifying questions and then kind of lay the roadmap for the future. Any clarifying questions? Senator Kunesh, would you like to add anything?
Oh, just that. Thank you very much to both of you for going through this and the amount of detail that it took to put this together. It's certainly a daunting project, and the fact that you have such knowledge and expertise is really impressive, and I just want to thank you. And members, if you do think of any questions after this, I guess on my side, if you do have questions to bring tomorrow, please write those down, maybe get them to us early, and if we can find the answers to that, we're happy to do that.
Thank you. And members, we do not have an intention to come back later tonight, but just in case, as we know this place is fluid, we are going to recess the committee, look for any postings for this afternoon. So with that, we stand in recess.